I am an expert on censorship. Not. The truth is, I'm as much an expert on censorship as all of you. And I'm not here to ululate about its supposed virtues, nor to stomp on its alleged sins. My intention this afternoon is to engage in objective discourse. Notice that the keyword here is objective. No passionate endorsements, no violent judgments, nothing to kill or die for. Just a brotherhood of man. An argument about whether censorship is a good thing or a bad thing rapidly deteriorates into accusations of who is more or less patriotic, moral, pious, etc. Value judgments invariably result in a domino effect. You don't like the way I think? Well, I think your philosophy sucks. And before you know it, the slightest thing achieves proportions of great magnitude, resulting in protests, demonstrations, and before you know it, even death. Is there an idea in the world that everyone agrees on? No, ladies and gentlemen, not one. And so much so that another thing that I find that people cannot agree on is the very definition of the term censorship. In itself, this appears to be a rather contentious, if not ironic, issue. Browsing through a pop culture website, the Fast Times Political Dictionary, to look for a synonym for the word censorship that would hit the nail on the head, I encountered a definition that I'm willing to settle for, and so I'm going to go with it. It also has the advantage of not taking longer than my allotted time to speak. I quote, "Censorship is the prevention of publication, transmission, or exhibition of material considered undesirable for the general public to possess or be exposed to." Unquote. Fair enough. In this, our media-saturated era, censorship is a fact of life. It is a byproduct of the process and impacts us and our ideas and thoughts, information that we share, receive, conceive, and assimilate on an everyday basis. The positives of censorship are kind of obvious. It protects children from obscene material. It prevents civic unrest in the name of race, religion, and politics. It preserves national secrets, sensitive military information, but this is not a hard sell for censorship. The downsides. Freedom of speech and thought and ideas are compromised. If sex-related topics are to be relegated to complete oblivion, then it becomes quite a task to teach teenagers about safe sex, pregnancy, and sexually transmitted diseases. Censorship may affect and impact the aesthetic of a book, film, play, or movie. Censorship may be used to mislead the general population and brainwash them to an extent. It may be used to quash reasonable complaint. Governments should not be controlling people. In fact, it should be the other way around. People should have a say in their governance. But then again, this is not a castigation of the concept. So what am I really on about? Censorship was far more straightforward in ancient times. The term comes from the Latin censere, to assess or give as one's opinion. Roman censors were magistrates who took the census count, as well as assessed and played the part of officers who assessed the character and morals of the people. The origin of the term censor can be traced to the office of the censor established in Rome in 443 BC. In Rome, as in ancient Greece, the ideal of good governments included shaping the character of the people, and hence censorship was considered an honorable task. And in its entirety and in its purest form, that is a noble thought. In today's context, however, it becomes a slightly different ballgame. For one, 2,500 years have passed. Surely we have attained some form of shape, attained some level of evolved maturity. Surely we need less supervision and monitoring by the powers that be. But do we really? That is another question and a whole other topic of discourse. And that is why I've carried my cushion along as I sit on the fence trying to make sense of this one. Technology is a tool that has placed great power in the hands that wield it. As Muhammad Ali had said before Adidas did, impossible is nothing. The act of censorship today is not straightforward at all. Anything that is censored will counterintuitively draw attention to itself. In fact, the very act of censorship belies its intention. Several examples come to mind. You read in the newspaper that a particular painting has been pulled from a gallery and banned from public display. You do not lie back in your armchair and breathe a sigh of relief that the morality of man has been upheld. You, in fact, go straight to your computer, Google the allegedly offensive artwork, and immediately get a good eyeful of it. It's another story altogether that art may not really be your scene. And unless that you had heard that it had been banned, you would have never really seen it in the first place. So by banning the painting, the authorities have actually led you right up to it by your reins. When David Fincher and his team decided not to release The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo in India in its unaltered form, as the censor board had deemed certain scenes unsuitable, what did everyone in India who wanted to watch the film do? They downloaded it. A majority of these people would have been much happier paying for the cinematic experience, watch it on the big screen with proper sound. But that was not to be. By banning an artist or an artwork and making a huge deal of it by breastbeating and protests and demonstrations and indignant interviews in the press, all you are doing is drawing more attention to a subject that you're actually trying to either forbid or filter. So it's self-defeating in itself, is it not? We censor each other in daily exchanges. Human beings are largely and inherently an argumentative people. We are intolerant of differences in opinion, and not in a friendly way either. Take one look at a televised debate on a news channel if you are not convinced of what I'm saying. Where there is an opinion, there will always be a counter, often a vociferous one. I don't think that one can take an extreme attitude or position on censorship. It's about treading the middle ground. Coming back to, actually concluding what I have to say, is I think one way forward is to possibly accept the inevitability of censorship and be judicious in our own reactions to it. Not overdo it and not to fan the flames. We need to basically agree to disagree and not disintegrate into a howling mob each time we encounter another person's point of view. Thank you.